Dear colleagues and friends, I'm happy to join the International Coordinating Committee, the commissions, the regional coordinating committees, the national chapters, and all the member organizations of the International League of People's Struggle in celebrating its 20th founding anniversary. I am proud to have been the chairman of the International Initiative Committee that prepared for its founding from 1998 onwards and founded it through the first International Assembly in Zutphen, Netherlands on May 25 to 27, 2001. Since then, the ILPS has become the largest, most articulate, most reliable, and most militant mass formation of its kind in the world. It has been constituted as an anti-imperialist and democratic alliance of mass organizations. As an alliance, it is not subordinate to any political party, government, or religious authorities. It affords equality to all member organizations and strives to realize the unity, cooperation, and coordination of anti-imperialist and democratic struggles throughout the world. As a result of revolutionary determination, hard work, and militant mass struggles, the ILPS has scored great achievements in promoting, supporting, and developing the anti-imperialist and democratic struggles of the peoples of the world, including the workers, peasants, women, youth, professionals, and other sectors of society against the ideological, political, military, economic, social, and cultural domination and attacks of imperialism and reaction. The ILPS succeeded in exposing and opposing the oppressive and exploitative policies and acts of the imperialist and puppet states, the multinational companies and imperialist-dominated international agencies such as the IMF, World Bank, and WTO, and the multilateral and bilateral military and other alliances of the imperialist powers aimed at oppressing and exploiting the peoples of the world. The significance and achievements of the ILPS are best appreciated when seen in historical context. The ILPS was founded under circumstances when U.S. imperialism was enjoying the status of sole superpower and winner of the Cold War and was boasting of the perpetuity of monopoly capitalism and the death of the socialist cause after the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991. The U.S. proclaimed a new world order and made it a point to aggress against Iraq, break up Yugoslavia, and expand NATO to the borders of Russia. The fluid situation was a consequence of the historic concatenation of the Cold War, the U.S. wars of aggression, neocolonialism, neoliberalism, and worst of all, the betrayal of the socialist cause by modern revisionism in both the Soviet Union and China. But of course, monopoly capitalism could never escape the laws of its motion. The worsening crisis of overproduction in the world capitalist system, the bursting of the high-tech bubble in finance, the 9/11 pretext of the U.S. for a perpetual war of terror in the name of anti-communism and anti-terrorism, the U.S. and NATO wars of aggression in Afghanistan, Iraq, Libya, and elsewhere, and the rising resistance of the peoples of the world. The full restoration of capitalism in the Soviet Union and China and their addition to the circle of imperialist powers have resulted in the intensification of contradictions among the imperialist powers, between the imperialist powers and the oppressed peoples and nations in the underdeveloped countries, and between monopoly capital and labor in the developed countries. All these contradictions would intensify during the first two decades of the 21st century, coinciding with the existence of the ILPS. They have coincided with the founding and growth of the ILPS. They have constantly required the International Coordinating Committee, the commissions, the regional coordinating committees, country chapters, and member organizations of the ILPS to pay attention to the current and long-running issues of oppression and exploitation, speak up, act on them and strive to mobilize the people against their oppressors and exploiters. To make sure that it attends to and acts on all the major issues that affect the people, the ILPS has listed in its charter the 20 concerns that its member organizations and the leading organs at every level must be aware of and must be ready to stand and fight for. The concerns are the following. 1. The cause of national liberation, democracy and social liberation against imperialism and all reaction. 2. Socioeconomic development for oppressed and exploited countries and nations, and social equity for all working people. 3. Human rights in the civil, political, economic, social, and cultural fields against state violence, national oppression, class exploitation and oppression, gender oppression, fascism, casteism, racism, and religious bigotry, and justice and indemnification for the victims of illegal arrest and detention, especially political prisoners, violations of due process, torture, extrajudicial executions, disappearances, mass displacement, and other blatant forms of human rights violations. 4. The cause of just peace and struggles against wars of counter-revolution and aggression and against nuclear, biological, chemical, missile, and other weapons of mass destruction. 5. Promotion of trade union and other democratic rights of the working class, improvement of wage and living conditions against all forms of intensifying exploitation of labor, and the destruction of working class organizations in their pursuit of the historic mission of fighting for social liberation. 6. Agrarian reform and rights of peasants, farm workers, and fisher folk against feudal, semi-feudal, and capitalist exploitation and oppression. 7. The cause of women's liberation and rights against all forms of sexual discrimination, exploitation, and violence. 8. Rights of the youth to education and employment. 9. Children's rights against child labor, sexual abuse, and other forms of exploitation. 10. Rights of indigenous peoples, national minorities, and nationalities for self-determination and decolonization against discrimination, racism, and national oppression by imperialism and local reaction. 11. The struggle of teachers and other education workers against imperialism and for an alternative future. 12. The right of the people to health and the rights of health workers. 13. Science and technology for people's development. 14. Arts and culture and free flow of information in the service of the people and the rights of artists, creative writers, journalists, and other cultural workers against imperialist and reactionary propaganda and oppression. 15. The rights and welfare of the diaspora, refugees and migrant workers displaced by imperialism and local reactionaries. 16. Rights of elderly and other differently abled people to a life of dignity and secure existence. 17. Rights of gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people against discrimination, intolerance, homophobia, and transphobia. 18. The rights of homeless, urban, poor, and internally displaced people against gentrification, forced evictions, containment, criminalization, and exploitation. 19. Defense of the environment against imperialist plunder and overproduction as the main causes of ecological degradation, resource depletion, and climate crisis. And 20. The struggle of faith-based associations against fascism and imperialism and for the attainment of just peace. The ILPS has made great achievements in promoting a common understanding of the aforementioned concerns and the related issues, in stimulating, facilitating, and coordinating common lines of action and undertaking definite actions within and among member organizations and mobilizing all possible organizations institutions and personages in further alliance, campaigns, and specific activities. Political education has been carried among the individual members of all the member organizations of the ILPS on the need for a broad anti-imperialist and democratic united front, an international people's solidarity in accordance with the Charter, General Declaration, resolutions, and decisions of the ILPS. The contents of these documents are propagated through advocacy, research, publications, conferences, seminars, and social and political action. All the member organizations and leading organs of the ILPS at all levels are alert to the international and national situation and take up issues promptly as these arise in the anti-imperialist and democratic struggles. They put forward their analysis and statements as current events and views arise and develop within their respective scopes of responsibility. They issue timely statements and conduct study meetings, seminars, and conferences on major issues in order to raise the political consciousness of their ranks and those that they wish to invite as member organizations or as allies. The commissions under the ICC have the special task of undertaking research, publications, seminars, and conferences on the various concerns for expanding and deepening the knowledge of all the constituents of the ILPS and for raising the consciousness of friendly organizations and encouraging them to join the ILPS. They have been instrumental in the founding of major international formations such as the International Migrants Alliance, the International Women's Alliance, and Workers' International Struggles Initiatives. They use the print and electronic media to spread the basic documents, primers, position papers, statements, and other reading materials. Under conditions of the COVID-19 pandemic, they have used the method of webinars to discuss major concerns and issues on an international scale. The ILPS has already had 6 international assemblies at the rate of once every 3 to 4 years. During and after every international assembly, there is an upsurge of determination and activity for strengthening the ICC, ICG, General Secretariat, commissions, the Global Region Committees, the country chapters, and member organizations through political education, organizational expansion, and mass campaign at various levels. There were more than 400 participants from 45 countries attending the 6th International Assembly. 285 were delegates from 213 member organizations. After the 6th International Assembly, the General Secretariat and Commissions of the ICC have been strengthened. The ILPS has risen to a new and higher level of activity in political education, organization, and mass mobilization. Country chapters continue to be formed where there are at least 3 member organizations deciding to form the chapter. Regional committees are formed wherever there are at least 3 national chapters deciding to hold a regional assembly and elect its committee. The ILPS now covers a substantial number of countries in Asia, Africa, Latin America, Europe, North America, and Oceania. Regional coordinating committees exist now in the following regions: Asia Pacific, Latin America and the Caribbean, Africa and West Asia, North America and Europe. The ILPS has made its political and organizational achievements on the basis of voluntary work and self-reliance in every activity. The resource base is limited to the membership dues and donations from the better off member organizations and from friends. There have been certain difficulties in collecting the membership dues. These have been adjusted in consideration of income disparities between developed and underdeveloped countries. More can be achieved by the ILPS if there's more funds. The leading organs, national chapters, and member organizations can raise funds by selling publications, meaningful paraphernalia, and tickets to cultural presentations, and by soliciting donations and funding for programs, projects, and campaigns. The fundraising can be done within the ILPS and among the allies and general public. With more funds that it can raise, the ILPS can accomplish more and probably provide honoraria to full-time personnel. In accordance with its policy of building the International United Front, the ILPS has initiated or joined mass hawk campaigns and activities and conferences along the anti-imperialist and democratic line of struggle. The ILPS has invited organizations and alliances to participate for the purpose of advancing the common cause and attaining mutual benefit. It has therefore augmented and amplified its own strength with that of other forces. In turn, these allies do likewise for their benefit. Under the same policy, the ILPS has participated in campaigns and activities initiated by other organizations and alliances. According to its capabilities, the ILPS has always been willing to initiate or join campaigns and conferences on various multi-sectoral and sectoral concerns and issues and in varying geographic scales. It has steadily developed its capacity to hold globally coordinated actions on major global issues, as well as specific regional or national issues that have global implications. There have been instances where a local struggle initiated or participated in by ILPS member organizations in certain countries have been supported by member organizations in other countries. The ILPS has sought and obtained the support and cooperation of national liberation movements, campaign centers, organizations, institutions, and alliances for the purpose of mass mobilizations. It has taken advantage of the contradictions among the imperialist powers and among the local reactionaries to expose and isolate the worst and most reactionary targets at any given time and place. Thus, it has further strengthened itself by prevailing of the mass mobilizations and broad international conferences to increase its member organizations. Since the mortgage meltdown in the U.S. in 2006 and global financial crisis of the world capitalist system in 2008, the world capitalist system has fallen into prolonged stagnation and depression. The strategic decline of U.S. imperialism has become increasingly conspicuous. The neoliberal policy of unbridled greed and the neoconservative policy of endless wars have proven to be counterproductive and bankrupting to the U.S. The crisis of overproduction has led to the current public debt bubble, which is about to burst in the faces of the imperialist powers and their puppet states. The inter-imperialist contradictions have become so severe that the main collaborators in propagating the neoliberal policy of imperialist globalization, the U.S. and China, have become the chief economic rivals and political rivals for world hegemony. The U.S. is trying to round up its traditional imperialist allies against the new imperialist powers, especially against China. All these imperialist powers can still compromise among themselves to some extent at the expense of the peoples and nations in the underdeveloped countries, as well as at the expense of the proletariat and people in the imperialist countries. But under the current conditions, the proletariat and people of the world are undergoing intolerable suffering from the escalating conditions of oppression and exploitation. They are being made to fight back by the extreme rigors of neoliberalism, state terrorism, wars of aggression, and environmental destruction by monopoly capitalism. The crisis of the world capitalist system has been aggravated by the COVID-19 pandemic, causing the unprecedented breakdown of economies and the loss of jobs and other means of livelihood. Altogether, the proletariat and peoples of the world are tormented by imperialist and class exploitation and oppression, the flow of resources to wars and production of weapons of mass destruction, the plunder of the environment and the global warming. All these are wreaking havoc on their lives, thus the people have no choice but to fight back. They are being driven to rise up in the struggle for national liberation, democracy, and socialism. The anti-imperialist and democratic mass struggles are spreading and intensifying on a global scale. that are signaling the resurgence of the world proletarian revolution. The prospects of the proletariat and peoples of the world and the International League of People's Struggle in particular are therefore bright. Thank you.